My name is Sasha Skenderia, so I am the program coordinator. I know many of you, some of them I will get to know very soon, and I'm here to introduce the day one. But before I do that, I just want to say a few words also that Director and Peter Collins haven't mentioned. The first one is the omnipresence of open access. So we had to get to find the position in which we will define and talk about open access. The different things is the open access is discussed among the librarians, mostly as a part of the publishing process. But here I want just to emphasize that one thing that we have in common, that open access and resource sharing is about both of that, is about removing barriers for users. So at that common point, we will talk, and we have here the expert, the distinguished three keynotes. The first one today is the Dr. Bianca Amaro, who came all the way from Rio, I guess, from Brasilia, from the capital, from the jungle, indirectly. From the here to tell us more things about how the things are going on the continent that we. I myself don't know very much about, especially about librarianship and then resource sharing and the open access initiative. To prepare myself for that, I read some of materials, and Dr. Amaro is a freshly 1 year elected the president of the South Africa consortium called Referencia. So we have the toppest of all top and most relevant people to tell us something of what's going on. The second note I wanted to do, before I see what I put there. Director mentioned about sharing, about the library, and about the reason that without we would not be here. If any of us, Harvard, even, or whoever, Library Congress, happened to have everything, there would not be the beautiful ILDS conferences. So on that point of view, when we started something doing strongly, taking a statement about sharing in the 90s, and the internet enable us to go step further and to include more and to serve with the information directly the users who were not around the Prague and surrounding area. So we made our first system that was a proto-subito. It was 1 year before them, or the same year as Ariel, from our colleague from Ohio. So we started and made some statements, defined, got interlibrary loan into the first copyright legislation that Czech Republic did. That thing had one idea. It was called library on your desktop. The idea was, if you are a member of our library and you have the web browser and the way of communication through us, so you are within reach of any resources available to the library systems in the world. The difference is only in the time and sometimes the price of access. So what we have in our acquisition, you can reach through us. What we can digitize and send to you. What we don't have, we will obtain to you through the interlibrary loan and document delivery sharing. So at that one point, for 3 years, the entire web presence, and we were the first in the world of that, was not based on OPAC or the info about services. It was the gate of the interlibrary loan. So that was the very pioneer concept that stayed with the idea. So we are the library, even we didn't have that beautiful building, but still were in a quite cool place at the Clementinum. Had the good IT and the people willing to share. And so I want just to say that as a keyword, that a library on your desk is about collaboration for users' benefit. So that's why we are here. The third one, something, that Peter said something about that. We are sharing resources, and among the resources for me, the most important are the people, that's our expertise. So the resource sharing movement is something that is the part, and the idealist is the deep part of that. We are sharing here our experience, our expertise, and that's, I think, that the most valued resource that we got to share among us. The last technical thing is this year, in attempt to improve, we met a few times, we wanted to to somehow raise the academic quality of our conference, because there is no too much literature on these topics going on, and those previous we have the problems. So some of the key authors, like our two professors from Finland, who are like most cited and key authors, they have not no opportunity to publish into the some focus journals on our topic. So we wanted them, and with the colleague Jarmo, who supported us in Kuala Lumpur, we stood up very strongly and stretched the wall. We want this time reviews, we want the quality, not only from those who are prolific into writing and publishing, but also to get our colleagues from the countries that don't use English as a mother language, who are not few, to go and to really to use it as educational opportunity to sit down, we who can share and have some experience to that, to those who don't have. So I'm very proud of the outfit of how those papers from our colleagues from countries that don't use English came out after the effort. And it was, for me, amazing experience, educational experience that we benefit very much from. At the end of my intro to day one, I have to say finally something about day one. The day one fund, those papers, this time you will vote the best paper presentation of a conference. You have chance to see, I had to read all the papers, so I know them all, and I know who will I give my vote, because profoundly I know them all, and few of us. Use your time, many of papers are amazing. They are all linked directly from the abstracts, or there are links to the page. Get them if you don't have time, just like glimpse into them, some take a peek, and follow the presentations. At the end of the day, you all got in your conference packages some weird brown bag, like the envelope, with a ballot list, with a ballot sheet. So at the last day of the conference, okay, you can choose your favorite even before you hear any and read that one, so you all have, but you have to write your name. Put that to the ballot, will be outside at the reference desk. So the best to hear that all or to read that all and to cast your ballot. You can choose only one and you have to sign your name. What you get for that, the last day, we will have here drawing, and then we will choose the three prizes that we don't have direct sponsors, because we have our ministry, beautiful ministry, who helped us, and we don't have vendors, not at least like revealed vendors, so they might be among us, but they don't act at least as explicitly as vendors. So that one little vendor that we didn't let them to be our vendor, but just let them to support the thing, they will give us the product. We will get from the we will get each one who is chosen, Wallen will get 20 access to 20 scientific articles from the whole thing. You can use that personally, or share with your library and bring back home. So, but you have to be here, you have to vote, and you have to be here that last day for the closing statement. Finally, today we are going through our program. I already introduced our keynote speaker for today. So this is in the section, as we said, the first in the we'll talk about open access as a way of getting rid of the barriers for the user's sake. As the conference proceeds, we will get to the other topic, the very, very nice paper that I read from our colleagues from Alberta, and especially for them I just want to emphasize, because they're in my zone, who sit down, and once they got empowered to do something about sharing the continent, they noticed the things that just because they were not librarians and involved in tradition, it somehow don't make sense. It makes sense to librarians. They care about that every single penny is paid for that, that all things are done. So they started, hello, the point of what we do is to uplift the people. So, and to get the thing where it's done. So they team with the, how to say, the new wave librarians, step into and shake the old systems and become with the hopeful news for all of us, and the examples to get bolder and then to do all the way like they do. During the day, we will have lunch time. Before the lunch, we will have a few more organizational announcements. We will go to section two. This is international section that we will hear very interesting things that I had no idea that are going on. So the digital divide, how those things are going on the huge billion point something scale with the central government who is driving those initiatives from one same in the pyramid from upside down. Our colleagues from Chinese are top experts, the very I'm uplifted, the young colleagues who came very knowledgeable of the things, and they started and they're implementing the modern things to the very specific system, so that I was really enlightened to read that. We will hear from Zimbabwe, from our other colleague, about the problems, so that we know most about, but we will hear from him how far or how bad those things are. And then we, for first time, we will have ever that I met our colleagues from Belarus from their prominent library, because as I read in Wikipedia, so that this agricultural country, and then the most prominent institution is the agricultural library. So also that we were working hard, both on both sides, they wrote, and maybe we were responding until we figure out something that is really presentable and good, and I'm really glad to hear them. As we go to coffee break, we will have coffee break all the time, and coffee is all the way there. You can go there. We go to the session perspectives, needs of scholars, the one that I personally most interested in. We have the great two things that I don't want even to say which one is better, one from China and one from Finland. And that's pretty much that. After that, we will have a little recapitulation, and then on insisting, when we got the conference, Peter and the other Peter Bey, who is not there, and Ertuğrul, said, we don't just want to sit in the field, we are in Prague, we want beer. Let us go just from program to program. So when we were building up the program, that was the first section build up. That first day, 16 plus is the first build thing up in the program. So for that, you are getting something that we really care about. We asked our colleague from Spain, the PhD student, who is here in the bioinformatics program, to do something, and who, by the way, is also, besides his technology and then a chemistry student, who in her free times do the beer guide for the Spanish-speaking people, to ask her, so how she sees and what she talks to those people who come. So it's not the view that I'm showing off as a domestic who know about the beer or some like tourist stupid thing that is just making you spend more money. This is the very honest view of the illustrator of two young women who came down, who know what they're talking, interpreting the beautiful voice. So we decided to put you that as a souvenir, and really, I recommend you doing that. Read that and go. There are 12 beers to try, so I don't think that you will be available to come the next day to the conference, but just try all of that, not to try all of them. So that's all. I would like to invite our first distinguished keynote, Dr. Bianca Amaro, to take a stand.
Well, good morning. First of all, I would like to say thank you to Peter for this kind invitation to be here, to have the opportunity to speak to you about Latin American and our activities relating in open action, open access. And I'd like to say thank you to Session for all the organization to be here. Well, it's an opportunity for me to present our region, first of all, because I think that we are not very known by the people. And because of it, I would like to present the context. Have you ever heard the term Global North? Global North? Well, but I'm sure that you have heard about Global South, isn't it? Sorry, I think that this kind of terms, it's a little bit pejorative, because I don't think that it's possible to speak about global everything, Global South. We have a lot of different perspectives. We have a lot of different economies and social conditions. And Latin America is made of 20 countries, 20 different countries. Here we are in this part of the world. I will present the situation of Latin America in relation to open access to scientific information. And you see that something unit us, but we are, in fact, very different. And I will be more specific talking about Brazil, my country. Brazil, in the situation of open access in Brazil. As you can see, we are a little bit big. We have the size of a continent, and we have the joys and the problems of a continent has. And we are very interesting. We are the only country of Latin America that speaks Portuguese. It's fantastic. No. Because we can't have a fluently conversation with our neighbors. We invent our language. We used to say that we speak Portuguese Spanglish, because we used to speak much more English than we speak Spanish. It's a kind of Portuguese things. But we are a enormous country, and our people, as you can see, we are 200,000 millions. Of people. And I'd like to talk about open access, the great visibility for science. As you know, my presentation is called Who is Does Not Visible Does Not Exist. And it's a reality for us in Latin America. And open access was a movement that brought to us an opportunity to make us visible to the world. We know that open access brings visibility to all the research, but for us it's much more important to correct the mistake claim that we in the South of the planet does not produce science. I've heard that sentence a lot of times in the congresses abroad. And I'd like to present to you the network La Referencia, a federated network of institutional repositories of scientific publication that was born by the reunion of our governments in 2012 and reflects the political will to offer in open access the scientific production of Latin America as a regional public good with emphasis on results financed with public funds. To the La Referencia search engine, it's possible to access more than 1,700,000 documents from Latin American scientific production. It's not so small production as you see. We are made up of 10 countries now. We are Argentina, Brazil, Chile, Colombia, Costa Rica, El Salvador, Ecuador, Mexico, Peru, and Uruguay. The Brazilian scientific production corresponds 17 percent of the total of the documents. It's a huge production. And we have other very important initiatives in the region related with the journals. We have, perhaps some of you knows, we have the initiative of Cielo. We have the initiative of Redalic and Latindex. These are the important indexers that make our journals increase their quality. Talking about specifically from about Brazil and its development around open access. We developed the Brazilian portal of open access scientific publication in order to gather and give visibility to scientific production in Brazil. And it was created by my institution, that it's Brazilian Institute for Information in Science and Technology. The Brazilian portal of open access scientific publications called Oasis BR, and it's a multidisciplinary portal that allows free access to full text Brazilian scientific production by Brazilian authors linked to universities and research institutions. We have a very important numbers. We have now, and it increases each day significantly, total of over 2,200,000 open access documents. You will not find it in many aggregators, but we have this total in Brazil. And what is made Oasis BR? The portal collection source consists the documents present in our Brazilian digital library of theses and dissertations, institutional repositories, and scientific journals. These are our main resources. The portal collection, to see the importance of our portal. The portal collection sources consist the documents present. I talked about that. We are collected by any other networks. We are collected by the national portal of Portugal named RECAP. We are collected in our Brazilian Digital Library of Theses and Dissertation by NDLTD, the National Digital Library of Theses, Network of Digital Library and Theses and Dissertations. We are collected by La Referencia, that is collected by the initiative Open Air from Europe. As you see, we can get more visible with our portal. We are, we are sending our production to several bounds of the world. These are our numbers of documents. We have a 500,000 of theses and dissertations from the Library of Theses and Dissertations. We have more than 1.5 million documents from our repositories, and we collect almost 1 million of scientific journals. And talking about scientific journals, we are present in several indexers. We are present in DOAJ, the Director of Open Access Journals. We are presented in Latin Index, as I said. In Scopus, our presence is not very strong, as you can see. Neither in Web of Science. And because of it, it's so important to us, the open access movement. Because we think that the metrics of that we use now, it's not a very important to measure our production. We produce much more than the metrics says that we produce. And I think that we have a problem, but you have a problem too. I don't think that this kind of metrics works to you too. Our production as a global view are much bigger than this kind of indexers says that we do. But we are presenting that too. My conclusions, because I would like to listen much more questions from you, is that we will continue with our hard work in open access. It's very important to make us visible. We are much more visible with open access. And we are now structuring ourselves to work with the open science. Specifically, on the umbrella of the open science, we are working now, structuring our government, our data. We are working to improve the creation of data repositories. And we expect to be more and more visible. And it's very important to us to be visible. We don't exist, isn't it, for you? It's very, how can I say? It's very, it's not strange, it's exotic. We are exotic. We are scientifically exotic. And we have to stop to be exotic. We have some kind of things in our countries that are exotic. But if you can see me, you can guess that I am a Brazilian woman. I don't think so. The immigration don't think neither. Every time I pass by the immigration, the people say, "Really? Are you Brazilian?" And I have to say, I feel sorry, but I'm Brazilian. And we have to change this view that the people have about that the people have about our scientific production. And we think that the open science is the way that the science will be improved by our research. I would like to thank you, and I am prepared to the questions. Thank you.
So, we have a microphone. We'd love to hear questions. I'm going to ask a first one, and then while there's an answer, I'll look around for anyone who raises their hand that wants to ask a follow-up question. I was really intrigued by what you said and how, in that raising the profile of Brazil and South America, how, as if we're not in the large aggregated sources. How do we get your scientific product to our researchers? Because they may not see it if they're in Web of Science, or I'm just naming one, but you know, one of those large aggregators. Do you have suggestions or ways locally that you're trying to make sure people can see the research, those 2.2 million articles and dissertations that are available?
Yes, yes. You can find our production here in Oasis BR.
Right.
It's our national portal that aggregates our production, the productions of the universities and the research institutes.
Right. Yeah, I think it's like how if someone isn't coming up in Google like a business, then they don't exist. I'm trying to think, how do we, I guess we need to be sure that we're including resources like that on our library web pages, and then also as resource sharing librarians, we know where to go to look for that material.
Uh-huh. You can go to Oasis BR to find the Brazilian production, and we can you can go to Livarencia portal to find the production of Latin American.
Excellent. Other questions?
Mirna Tabit from Qatar. I just have a question. So when a faculty is considering for his promotion or her promotion, do you use Oasis BR as the portal to evaluate? Because we have the same problem in Qatar. We do have open access, but when it comes to evaluating the input or the measuring the impact of the research, we still use the university still uses Scopus and Web of Science. So all our efforts go towards open access, but by the end of the day, when it comes to measuring impact or evaluating, we still use those big aggregators.
I think that it's a global problem. Nobody used, until now, the documents in open access. We, the world, is still using the Web of Science, the Scopus, and the Web of Science. And we know that they don't fit us, but it's the tradition, and we know that the North have to change first. Please change. Please. Please. Because if the North changes, we will change too. We are expecting. We have a lot of discourse, a lot of initiatives in open access, related with open access, but I believe that we have to touch in the most important thing, is how to measure the researchers. If we still, we still use the same measure, nothing will change. Nothing. That's my point of view. I'm waiting. Wait, Qatar. Wait. I'm patient.
Hello, my name is Kimmo Tuominen from University of Helsinki, Finland. Yes, thank you very much for the interesting presentation. And I think the problems with metrics, they are everywhere, also concerning disciplinary differences and social sciences and humanities are not at all visible in Web of Science and so on. But my question concerns more of this conception of immediate open access and plan as have you, like in South America, you know, the initiative plan S and so on. Have you any official position concerning it? Because if this plan S becomes reality, it has to become reality everywhere. So that's why I would like to hear your comments.
The world will be wonderful if the plan S works. And officially, as the president of La Referencia, I can tell you that we agree with the plan S in general, but we are expecting the plan S in fact, because the plan S is an idea, it still is an idea of change. But as I said, we are expecting to see what the North will gonna do with the plan S, to take the words off the paper and to put it in action. It's very important.
Hi, this is Silvana Mangiaracina, National Research Council, Italy. How do you manage with embargo periods of publishers?
Well, we have, in Latin America, we have the tradition of open access. So we don't have many journals that have problems with embargo, first. The second is we wait. We wait. Yes. Well, we are learning to the researcher to start to negotiate with the editors. But we are talking about the Elsevier. We have a problem, and we are waiting for. We are trying to change the contracts, but we have the same problem that anyone has. But the journals in Latin America are mostly in open access, and so it's not a huge problem for us. It's the same problem that you have in Europe with the embargoes. We are trying to learn. Yes. We are trying to learn to present first to researchers. Welcome to the real life. Welcome to the contracts of the copyrights. You have first, after being super happy to be accepted to publish in Nature, for example, you have then to start the negotiate with the publisher to have an embargo, the period of the embargo, smaller than 2 years, for example. We are trying.
Hi, thank you so much for your talk. Hillary Thompson, the University of Maryland in the United States. I have a similar question about embargoes, but it actually pertains to the theses and dissertations by graduate students in both of these repositories. So are all of these works immediately available as open access, or may the authors elect to embargo their works for a period of time? And if so, what might be common time periods?
Well, our production is, we don't have much embargo in Oasis BR. And the embargo, it's not an embargo for example, for in 2 years embargo, for example. The embargo that we have, that it's the same, as I said. And the students are much more interested in open access. It's easier to learn, to make the, to change the mind of the students than the old researcher. I always say a joke that we have to kill the old researchers. I will die too, huh? I will die too. Because we had to change the things, and the things are much structured. And it's very difficult to say to an old researcher, recognized researcher, you have to publish now in open access. What? No, let the things going on. Let the things going on. Why change the thing that is working? It's the discourse of the people.
Thank you very much, Dr. Amaro. Yep. It was very inspiring. I hope we have many breaks, coffee breaks, social events, and informal possibilities. So enjoy that and find a way to get Dr. Amaro to your table or to get close to her table before she leaves us tomorrow.